Happy Friday afternoon to everyone. My name is David Howell, and I'm really excited to be with you to share some time with you today and get into the Word. It's an exciting time in our society right now. We're going through some interesting things, and we're going to address some of that in God's Word today, but it's going to be an exciting time. I'm going to give it a little bit of time while people are logging on, but in the meantime, I'd like to make a couple of announcements regarding our 21 days of prayer. This is day six. The next three Saturdays in a row, we're going to be meeting at 9 a.m. here at the church, and we're going to meet for a one-hour time of prayer and worship and a little message, and it's going to be a great time. And then Monday through Friday, the next 2 weeks, we're going to meet at 12:45 just like we are here. We'll gather together online just like you are right now. So with that, I'd like to get in just by starting, and I'm going to read the word, just the text that I'm going to use. And then we'll dissect it and make some real good sense out of it. It's from Proverbs 3, verses 1 through 4. If you'd like to find it later or read along, that's great. And it says, "Wisdom bestows well-being, my son. Do not forget my teaching. But keep my commandments in your heart, for they will prolong your life many years and bring you peace and prosperity. Let love and faithfulness never leave you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on the tablet of your heart. Then you will win favor and a good name in the sight of God and man." Now there's a lot in that, and I'm going to try to dissect that so that it makes a little bit more sense, and it'll hopefully really come together for you, because it's extremely meaningful wisdom that we get out of the Word. The first verse says that wisdom bestows well-being, my son. Do not forget my teaching. The first thing that I want you to get out of that is the understanding that there's, I'm going to call it three different levels. There's what's called wisdom, or understanding, knowledge, and wisdom. The first one of those three that I just did a little backwards, the first one is the knowledge. That's what I call the head knowledge. You can put stuff up in your head, but actually having it make sense to you may take sometimes years before it dawns on you. That's what I call the aha moment, and that only comes when we spend time in the Word of God, when we actually read it and contemplate it and ask God for help and understanding and help for that to start making sense for us. When you all of a sudden you go from the 18 inches from your head, from that head knowledge, and it gets into your heart, that's what I call the heart knowledge or the understanding. That's when you have that aha moment, and all of a sudden the Word starts to come alive to you, and applying the Word starts to come alive to you, and that's exciting when that happens. It mentions wisdom in this. Wisdom is what happens based on what we get into our hearts, what we allow in our hearts. Wisdom is what flows from our hearts when it's full of God and full of God's Word. It's that wisdom that starts flowing out, doing what it should do, and it changes our behavior as we go along in ways that are so comfortable. You'll amaze yourself when you're out there talking to people, and you'll walk away going, "Wow, was that me? Did I think of that, or was that from God?" It's a wonderful thing when that starts to happen. Now, why does all that happen? Wisdom bestows well-being. Wisdom helps to give you well-being. When you are applying the Word of God, you feel better, you live better, you have a better impression on people all over the country. Every place you go and you meet people, more specifically in your own community, in your own household, which is where we need to really be leaders. Verse 2 says, "But keep my commandments in your heart, for they will prolong your life many years and bring you peace and prosperity." Now, I always ask myself, who wouldn't want to live a long life? Well, I would, but I qualified that. I want good health and good finances. Sometimes that doesn't happen. That's where the well-being comes in. When you feel better, you can tolerate almost anything, and that's a great thing to see. Notice that it says, "But keep my commands in your heart." Keep, that means to hold on to it, keep it, and it doesn't say remember it. It doesn't say stick it in your head and remember it later. It says keep it in your heart. That's because you've got understanding now, and it becomes, I'm going to say, etched in there. We'll see that in a minute. His commands, his teachings, and his word. When we put that in our heart and we get that solidly in our heart, things begin to change. They will prolong our life for many years, and they will bring us prosperity and bring us peace at the same time. Again, I want to emphasize, it's not the head knowledge that's the important piece there. We can study and learn and get all the book learning until we're blue in the faith, but in the face, but until we actually start applying it, it's just not the same. When you start applying it, all of a sudden your heart wakes up and your heart starts to feel it. And remember, God's looking for a man's heart. God searches a man's heart for who they are. And that's what we need to make sure that we're feeding. All the intellect in the world will do us, I mean, it is some good, obviously, but all the intellect is not going to make the difference, but it's that heart knowledge, the understanding of God, the understanding of His Word, the understanding of how to apply it, and then applying it that makes all the difference in the world. Why all that? Because it brings us long life, peace, and prosperity. Notice it's not unlike the promises of God. There's always something that we need to do, and there's always a promise that God gives us in return for what we do, for our actions. Verse 3, the entire verse says, "Let love and faithfulness never leave you. Bind them around your neck and write them on the tablet of your heart." That is extremely meaningful to me, but it's got to be looked at in two different pieces of scripture. The first one says, "Bind them around your neck." Now, what in the world does that mean? I prayed about that and pondered that for a long time. What it boils down to is when a woman wears a necklace, why does she do that? She does that to draw attention to herself, right? Maybe draw attention to herself, but because it's beautiful. It looks nice. It's an adornment. It's a beautiful thing. That's what the Word of God does when we bind it around our necks. It's the same thing. When we go out in the world in which we live, whether it be at work, at home, in our communities, or down the road, wherever we go, we need to make sure that we let people know. Now, you don't hit them over the head with the Bible, but by your actions, by your smile, by who you represent, that's what you need to represent or show to people, is what, who we are and who we represent. When we do that and we have that, and it's natural, it's like wearing a piece of jewelry. It's like wearing an adornment on our necks that makes all the difference in the world between what people see and what they don't. The one thing I've heard before, not necessarily about me, but sometimes you can imagine hearing that. The reality is, the worst thing that can happen is somebody could say, "Is that you? I had no idea you were a Christian," when you do something that's Christian-like. You don't want to surprise anybody like that. You want people to know it every day during your walk. And notice again, it says, "Bind them and keep them," and it doesn't say keep them in your heart for a short while. That's what happens when it goes into your mind. You keep it for a short while, at least in its true context. But when you bind it to your heart, all of a sudden it's understanding. All of a sudden it's something that you keep forever. And that's critical. This one's important. I want you to really get this. It says, write them on the tablet of your heart. When you write something on the tablet of your heart, this, again, hang on to this one. In those days, they did not have, when they talked about a tablet, it was not going and getting your yellow pad and writing something down. It wasn't a tablet like this, like an iPad. It was a tablet. It was usually a thin piece of stone that they would chisel something into. That's the context here. They're telling us that we should chunk it into or chisel it into our hearts so that it is got staying power and it stays, kind of like engraving. That's what we want to do with God's Word and our heart. That's where the understanding, that's where the solid belief and the solid practice in your life comes from. Then in verse 4, I think this one's really special to me. It says, then, and this is the benefit to us, really the benefit to everybody if you're applying God's Word, then you will win favor and a good name in the sight of God and man. Now, how many times do you hear us or people talking about, don't do things to please man, do things to please God? And that's absolutely true. We should do things because God wants us to do it in a certain way or have a certain impact. But all of a sudden, here's the Word saying very clearly, without a doubt, when you do this, you're going to win favor and a good name. That's a good reputation. That's a very positive thing. That's earning respect, but you earn it. It says win here in this context, but it means to earn a good reputation in the sight of both God and man. That is a powerful thing. That is a powerful statement. Again, I can't stress enough, it's the difference between the knowledge, the head knowledge, which is information, the heart knowledge, which is understanding, and then applying it in the wisdom that comes out of you, that comes out of your heart every day for the rest of your life And that is a blessing, to say the least. Again, let me just go into prayer, and then I'll remind you of some of the things that are going on here at church. So let's pray. Father, we come before you and we praise you. We thank you so much for the opportunities that you give us to serve you, to get into your word, to love one another, and to fellowship together. We thank you so much, Lord Jesus, for all that you provide for us. Use this word today to not just go into our heads and become knowledge. Help it, Lord Jesus, to sink into our hearts, and help us to continue to ponder it, continue to study it, continue to dwell on it, until all of a sudden we have that aha moment. Each one of us has that aha moment, and these things begin to make sense, and we begin to understand them. We begin to understand how to apply them and make them real in not just our lives, but in the lives of others. We thank you so much for those opportunities. Thank you, Lord Jesus, once again for the opportunity for us to be together today. In Jesus' name, amen. Again, just as a reminder, we have 21 days of prayer. Monday through Friday, we're meeting here, 12:45, Monday through Friday, online, just like we did today, this week and next. Then we have three Saturdays where we're meeting at 9 a.m. The next three Saturdays, 9 a.m., and we're going to meet here for a prayer service in the building. And then we want to thank you, first of all, for joining us. But I wanted to say particularly, we hope to see you again really, really soon. God bless all of you. Have a wonderful day and a wonderful weekend. God bless you.